Hi, it's Phil Harris again. This time we're doing the late great Paul Kossoff. One of my idols, when I first started to play guitar, Paul Kossoff was actually one of my three main influences. One was Paul Kossoff, which was like the vibrato and the real feel and the real sort of slow down and dragging the note. And the sort of very sort of sparse playing with not feeling like you have to put a million notes in. The complete opposite to him at the time in 1968 when I first sort of got into his playing was Alvin Lee. And I got into Alvin for the speed and the sort of spontaneity and the sort of bounciness of his style and the phraseology. Then the Paul Kossoff, as I said earlier, for the sort of that really dragging that note. And when I got into playing a Les Paul by sort of early 69, my first Les Paul, I really fell straight into that sort of thing for Kossoff. And I always loved Hendrix. He's my sort of third sort of thing, whereby the ability to let go, the ability to be able to sort of get out there where the fair is, as they say these days. That was my three influences. But back to Paul. I have been very fortunate to have owned several of Paul's instruments, but unfortunately since his death. Two of his Les Pauls I actually could have bought while he was still alive. Which was the natural fronted Les Paul Standard, the one he used famously on Top of the Pops for the All Right Now song. And the other one was, in fact, the Les Paul that he had right to the end when he died, the one that he broke the neck around about the back of the fifth fret. And Gibson do a reissue of this now that I've seen Arthur Ram, who's the present owner of that guitar, who kindly let me use it at the guitar show in May this year, which you'll also see in this article when I'm playing that one. That was a guitar that Paul actually had at the time of his death. The reason they were both for sale in the Orange Shop at the time in 1974, 2 years before Paul died, was something unfortunately very sad. Because at the time, Paul, as we all know, had certain habits and things, and he sold both those guitars to furnish that. And one of the guitars, the Sunburst of the two, was bought back by his management or record company, I don't know which he then kept until he actually died. So those guitars were for sale, and I will let you know the price in 1974. The natural Les Paul Standard that we associate with the Isle of Wight Festival and All Right Now was £550. So if you work out with inflation, it still doesn't come down to a deposit on what it would be worth today. And the Sunburst guitar, because of the neck break, that was for sale for £450. So you could have bought both of those for £1,000 a pair in 1974. But I'm very happy that Paul got the Sunburst guitar back and used it to make some fantastic music until his untimely death in 1976. That was quite a privilege for me to have a go on those and see them at the time. I also saw Paul Kossoff in the same shop, Orange, and it was really quite funny looking back on it. You got this shop that's full of equipment. In those days, you didn't have like walking areas, and there was no sort of making an environment for people to buy stuff. It was just a shop full up to the gills with equipment. You had guitars on the wall, in front of that a wall of amps, and another wall of amps the other side, with like a galley in the middle, and that's where you walked in and out the shop. And one day I walked in there to see Cliff Cooper was the owner, as we now know from the Orange amplification that he started back in the day in 68 in the Orange shop. And his assistant, his manager at the time, right through that period, was an old friend of mine called John Bates. And I went there one day, I used to pop in there and hang out, and as we all did at that period. And I went there one day, and there's this Paul Kossoff was just sitting on top of a Marshall 4x12 cabinet. And he was quite, I'm 6'2", and he's like, to me, he's like, I'm like a giant, he's like this little guy. And he was sitting there, and they were trying to do business and talking. And at the time they were trying to do this, Paul was playing flat out through a 100-watt Marshall into this 4x12 cab he was sitting on. And no one would tell him to be quiet, because obviously, A, it's Paul Kossoff, and B, just to be able to hear him, everyone didn't want to stop him playing a note, because I was basically just listening to him, the brilliance that man had in his fingers was amazing. And I remember many years later talking to his father about that, because as luck would have it, not long after Paul died, not I don't mean that being luck that he died, obviously, but just after Paul died, I had a 58 Les Paul Standard, and I decided in those days I needed a spare. And it sounds very, very frivolous by today's standards, but you've got to bear in mind there was about £600, £700 in 76, you could still find one. Although it's a lot more than today with inflation, it's still not a fraction of what these things are now. Anyway, I rang up John Bates and he gave me a couple of numbers. One of them was a guy called Terry Newman who played in a band called Power Pack. And basically what actually happened was I got his number, I called him, and his wife had just had a daughter he just had this in 76, just after Paul had died. And so he said, I actually would sell you the Les Paul. So I went to his house. It was a dark fronted 58 standard. Terry, unfortunately, had refinished the neck and done other bits and pieces that I had to later on get Roger Giffin to put right for me. The guitar sounded awesome. I was really happy with it. And I bought it. I gave him a Les Paul custom, I think £220 or something like that. And I walked out with the standard. Went to my friend's house, who's actually now he's retired from the business, but he was a really good player and he worked with Chris Rea and all sorts of people, a guy called Tommy Willis. Went back to Tommy's house because Terry Newman lived in East London and Tommy lived in East Ham. So we went back to his house and we put the guitar on a stand, these little wiry old stands. We was having a cup of coffee and talking about it. All of a sudden we heard a clank and the back leg of the stand fell away, as if it had been cut right through. It was really weird. And the guitar went back about 6 inches and just went donk and rested on the windowsill. At which point Tommy and I were actually both mortified by this, thinking that Paul had only been gone about sort of that time, about 3 months, if that. And we was convinced that this was the ghost of Paul Kossoff. There's probably a real reason other than that, but when you're like, you know, 20 odd years of age and your idol's just passed away, you know, and you just literally set out to buy a guitar and wound up with one of his main Les Pauls. It was a bit of an awesome day in a lot of ways, and I could see why that possibly Tommy and I were like quaking in our boots. I actually sold that guitar a few years later. It ended up going to Paul Rogers at the end of the day. And I actually met Paul in 1981 after this time, and saw the guitar, used it in a calendar that I was doing in the late 80s, and Paul was always very helpful. I then received a call from Paul in, I think it was the year 2000, saying he wanted to give the guitar to David Kossoff for the Paul Kossoff Foundation. It was a wing in a hospice in Hatfield, I think it is, the hospital. And it was a Paul Kossoff wing. And David Kossoff had taken up doing sculpturing. And he'd done an amazing bust of Paul. It was like looking at him. And we were going to sell the guitar to raise money for the foundation, for the Wald. So anyway, I was put in charge of actually selling the guitar. So the guitar was returned to me from Paul Rogers. I had worked previously at Christie's, the auction house, so we put it to Christie's and it was sold to an American collector, I've been told since, who still has the guitar. And what I didn't find out, well, I never knew, I bought Paul Kossoff's guitar back in 76 and owned it and sold it to Paul Rogers and whatever. What I never knew, it was the same guitar that Paul Kossoff had bought from Eric Clapton on the Blind Faith tour after Cream had split up. So Clapton had the Beano guitar, it's a famous guitar, his 1960 Beano guitar, that was stolen. Then he went and replaced it in Cream, early Cream, with this dark Les Paul that he used, which I've been told he used on the first two Cream albums, Fresh Cream and Disraeli Gears, which he got some great sounds on. Two fantastic iconic albums. And then he done a swap with Kossoff because Paul had a black Les Paul custom triple pickup that Eric liked, so they done a swap. And so I only found out many, many years later that I not only owned Paul Kossoff, one of his main Les Paul standards, but it also come from Eric Clapton. So it was like a double whammy, you know, so I was really happy about that. And it was nice to actually be involved with doing something for Paul's memory, with and meeting David. Obviously, I grew up with David Kossoff in films, seeing him around as a famous actor, even reading Bible stories on a Sunday night when I was a kid growing up. Meeting David was really nice, and going to his house, and he showed me different things to do with Paul and some personal things that I really wouldn't discuss, but I'm very privileged to have actually been involved with the Kossoffs. Unfortunately, I think it was 2005, David passed away, and I was very privileged to be invited to his funeral, which was a very typical flair of David Kossoff. There's some parts there, and people said some wonderful things about him. There were some very nice people, and obviously Paul's brother, David's other son, Simon Kossoff, was there, and they made me ever so welcome, and it was a very fitting time to someone that I was very close to musically, his son, when I grew up and learnt to play, to then be of use to Paul's memory in a raising money for charity for his name, and to have met his dad and had that involvement with David Kossoff. So it's a few things. I know people, we know now that Paul worked in Selma's, which I frequently as a youngster went in and out of, and my older brother Morris. But Paul would have, even the years that they say that he worked there at that particular time, I was going in and out of that shop with my brother, but I never actually saw him. I would have done, but not to know who he was at the time, and I don't actually have a recollection of seeing this guy, which I know to be Paul Kossoff. The funny thing happened last year was someone actually approached me with the first Les Paul that Paul owned, which is a black Les Paul Black Beauty, I think it's 1955, that I did own for a short time. I've since let that guitar go. I've sold the guitar to a collector. So it was great when I'd done this Northern Guitar Show, because I had, I went up there with a Peter Green Gary Moore standard that was in my possession at the time to do the show. I had a word with Arthur Ram, the present owner of the last standard Sunburst, as I said earlier, and he brought that up, which was really good, so I got a chance to play that as well. And while I was there, a guy showed up with one of Keith Richards' Les Paul standards, which was amazing, from Exile on Main Street, the album that guitar was mainly used on, which was really a great experience to have all these famous, iconic Les Paul standards. And I also took the Black Les Paul Custom, the first Les Paul. So at that show, I had the last Les Paul that Paul owned and actually died with, and the first Les Paul he had as a young chap, I think probably about 14, 15 years old, but his first Les Paul. So it was quite a very memorable day, and some of the footage from that day, some film footage that we've got, will be used in this particular article. So that should be of interest, seeing me play that other Les Paul, the last one he had, and still showing some pictures of the first one, the Black Les Paul Custom Black Beauty. Thank you. I just want to close by saying I'm really pleased to have been able to have done this, and I hope you guys enjoy it along with the footage of me playing the other guitar, the Paul Kossoff guitar, and having a go on my own Les Paul, to sort of basically do some sort of, let's say, Paul Kossoff-esque, because I'm not a person but copying someone. That's Paul Kossoff, done it for real. I just do my sort of take on it and the influence that he gave me, that I will take with me to the grave, and I thank him for that. And thank you very much for listening, and I hope you enjoy this particular article. Thank you.